Yeah, herzlich willkommen. Very welcome to the Elevate Festival 2014. I'm happy to welcome also the viewers and listeners on Octo TV, Dorf TV, TV and Radio Helsinki to our event right now. My name is Daniel Erlacher, and the title of this event is Reality is the Next Big Thing. How Google and others try to, well, invade our reality. I'm going to split this event in two parts. In the first part, we're going to analyze the situation. We're going to make it hopefully as clear as possible what the problem is. And in the second part, in the second hour, I want that we discuss a little bit what can be possible alternatives or ways out of this dilemma, this problem that we're facing right now. I also want you, the audience, here in the room and also online, to participate with us. We have a special hashtag for this event. It's E14Reality. You can discuss through Twitter, the social media platform, but you can also send comments. If you don't want to use Twitter, you can send comments on the Elevate website at the special site for this event. My name is Daniel Erlacher. I'm one of the curators of the Elevate Festival, and I'm happy to welcome some guests here on stage. And from Harvard University, Shoshana Zuboff. Welcome.
Thank you, Daniel.
Shoshana Zuboff is a Charles Edward Wilson Professor of Business Administration at the Harvard Business School and a faculty associate at the Berkman Center for Internet Society at Harvard University. Shoshana has written several very interesting articles this year at the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung and has more or less also sparked a very important debate. Shoshana will shortly, in a few minutes, give a short keynote about describing what she wrote in these articles. Here on stage on the panel with me, I welcome Micah Lee from the States. He was here already at the festival yesterday and at the opening event. He's a security technologist and a chief technology officer and board member of the Freedom of the Press Foundation and the author of Encryption Works. He works for The Intercept, the medium of Glenn Greenwald. And yeah, welcome to the Elevate Festival.
Thank you.
Miriam Rasch comes to us from Amsterdam, from the Institute of Network Cultures of the Hogeschool from Amsterdam. Very welcome.
Thank you.
And to my left, Felix Stalder. He's a professor of digital culture and network theories at the Zurich University of the Arts and a member of the World Information Institute in Vienna. Welcome. Shoshana Zuboff, you wrote a very, for me at least, very inspiring article that sparkled the debate in the German Feuilleton. Dark Google was the name of this article, and you're also writing a book. I would ask you to give the short keynote and then explain, maybe also point out the book that you're working on.
Okay, thank you, Daniel. I'd love to. You can hear me well and all of that's working?
Yes.
Excellent. All right. Well, first of all, hello to the audience. It seems like it's an amazing group of thinkers and activists and music lovers. I'm very honored to be here among you, although I'm kind of sorry I can't be there in person and join the party because it sounds like it'd be a great party tonight. anyway. I do want to talk to you about the theme of dark Google. As Daniel mentioned, I wrote a piece on this in the FOTS that came out last April, and another piece on this theme that just came out in September. One was called Dark Google, the other was called Our Digital Declaration. These are the themes I want to discuss with you today. But before I get right to dark Google, I want to pose a question, and that is, why does Google matter? So I want to expand our horizons a little bit and create some context for us to think about why we should be concerned about Google and the way it's developing. So as Daniel mentioned, the Harvard Business School, I spent 25 years as a professor at the Harvard Business School. As you can see, I started when I was 12. And during that time, I saw a new business model take root and rise to dominance. This is a business model that I consider to be contemptuous of humanity and contemptuous of our planet. You can call it neoliberalism, financial capitalism, shareholder capitalism. The label is less important than understanding its consequences. What's becoming clear to many, many people today is that this model has taken us to a new destructive situation and points to an even more dangerous future. A future that's characterized by exclusion, stratification, inequality, but also the reactions to those things. What do I mean by that? Fundamentalism, despair, violence, and also the reactions to those things, repression, resistance, extremism, all issues that we are engulfed in right now. I don't know if any of you have seen it, but you know, there's this great research operation, the Pew PEW Research Center. And just the last week, they released a very interesting survey where they asked people in the EU what they regard as the biggest threat to the future. And overwhelmingly, people in the EU said the biggest threat is inequality, the social divisions that are being created in our society. The people in the EU are right. This is the biggest threat to our future, both because of the kind of society that it's creating and the potential for violence in our societies, but also because we know from studies of civilizational collapse that the more stratified and unequal a society is, the more prone it is to collapse and resource depletion. And the reason is that when you have elites who are separated, dramatically separated from the rest of society, they have ways of buffering themselves from the negative consequences of resource depletion, and they refuse to take leadership to change the situation because it might alter their status and their opportunities. So both in terms of nature and people, a stratified society is a dangerous society. And I don't mean that everyone is supposed to be exactly equal, but I do mean that these extreme social divisions are very, very dangerous. Some of you might have heard of this recent book that was written by Thomas Piketty, the French economist, about capital in the 21st century.
So that's a Harvard office that we're seeing right there, right?
All right, this is the book. You can see that it's a very thick book, all right? And I want you to see that because I want you to know a little bit about what Piketty is saying. Most people don't read the book. There's a study that was done that figured out most people read the first 25 pages. But basically, the message is this. Piketty shows that the problem we're facing is not capitalism per se, but rather what happens to our societies when capitalism is allowed to develop without any social constraints. Think of it as a raw, unshackled capitalism. And it's that kind of capitalism that produces inequality. So I've been able to reduce this very thick book to one sentence. Okay, you ready for it? My sentence is, capitalism is not intended to be eaten raw. Okay? Don't eat capitalism raw. And the point that I'm making is that we need laws and we need social institutions and we need the collaboration amongst us in a democratic spirit in order to cook capitalism and make it edible. Okay? And that's the stuff that we have lost in the last 30 years. So, While all this was going on, many of us took refuge in the online world. And we went there to find new sources of autonomy and freedom and creativity, to build lives outside of these barriers that were being erected in this world of raw capitalism. But the thing that we need to understand now is that the online world, which used to kind of be our world, is now becoming the new zone where capitalism is developing in new ways, new forms, and where capitalism is operating. So here comes the question. Will these new forms of capitalism that are developing in the networked world, are they going to solve the problems that we face today? Or are they going to make these problems worse? All right, we can no longer treat these as two separate zones. These have become the same world. Now, when we look at the network world, I think, and this is part of what my book is about, that there are some very exciting and positive developments for capitalism in our online world. But there are also some really dangerous developments. And they are developments that are really hard to theorize, hard to grasp, because in some ways they have been designed to be undetectable. They're designed to be invisible. This is the context in which Google matters, because Google is one of the biggest actors, perhaps the biggest actor in the online world. And I want to say that Google matters not just because of the immense amount of money that it has amassed, not just because of the unimaginable concentration of information power that it has amassed, but because of this. Google has pioneered a wholly new business logic, new in the history of capitalism. And this new logic is becoming the model, has already become the model, for most new online businesses, applications, and online startups. If the Google model becomes the dominant model of the online world, it becomes the dominant model of the future of capitalism. And that is a very dangerous prospect, and I'm going to tell you why. The first thing you need to know about Google is that we are not its customers. I have a feeling most of you already get this, but it's worth repeating because it is extraordinary and completely unique in the history of capitalism. Google's customers are its advertisers and the others who purchase their data analyses. Google is thought of as a big data company, in fact, the biggest big data company, because it has the most users. But as users, we are simply the source of the data that it analyzes for its customers. They call it data exhaust because that's meant to connote that it's waste and it doesn't matter, when actually it's the stuff about our lives. So whatever else we want to say about modern capitalism, going back to the beginning of the 20th century and before, think about this. Capitalism has always depended upon its populations for two things. One is for employees, and the other is for customers. This is no longer true. In the Google model, it employs very few people. The whole company only employs about 48,000 people. So it's not really looking to us for employees. Just as a point of comparison, General Motors in 1958, at the height of its power, was the largest private employer on the planet. All right, so that gives you an idea of the way we flip this model. The only thing that Google needs people for is data. And this means that data is everything. Data is becoming everything. Every time you brush a key or whisper past your cell phone, that's data, and that's stuff that Google wants. So the ugly truth here is that this so-called big data is actually plucked from our lives without our knowledge and without our informed consent. I call it the poisoned fruit of a rich array of surveillance practices designed to be invisible and undetectable as we make our way across the virtual, but now also the real world, not just our online behavior, but walking in the street, walking into a shop, and pretty soon getting into our cars. Of course, all of this is further complicated by the fact that there are also highly undetectable and invisible collaborative arrangements with state security apparatus, state security operatives in our various countries. And these are also hidden from our inspection. It's also complicated by the fact that the pace of these developments is accelerating, because a company like Google is now investing in drones, in wearable technologies, in the smart devices for our homes, the Internet of Everything. And all of this is creating a massive digital infrastructure of, quote, big data that I prefer to call big contraband or big stolen goods, because these things were taken from us without our permission. And because of that, we're actually looking at a new asset class. These data constitute a new asset class, and I'm calling that asset class surveillance assets. And surveillance assets attract to them a great deal of investment. And I'm calling that investment surveillance capital. And so now we're beginning to see the picture where what we've created in Google is a, you know, what you would call, when you're thinking about capitalism, a new logic of accumulation. And this is accumulation by surveillance. In other words, this is a wholly new economic model in the history of capitalism, and I'm calling it surveillance capitalism. What is key here to understand is that populations, that means all of us, no longer exist to be employed and served. We exist to be harvested, for behavioral data. Now, the objective of a company like Google is quickly moving beyond just analyzing data about what we've already done to analyzing data about what we're doing right now, to actually analyzing data to predict what we might do, to actually intervening in thousands and thousands, actually, of very subtle ways to modify our behavior, to shape our behavior in order to try and determine what we will actually do next. And the point is that every single point in that process is going to be monetized and marketized, turned into revenue streams for Google, for its advertisers, for the others who are bidding on opportunities to modify our behavior to serve their financial interests. And that's why Daniel calls this reality is the next big thing, because what I've argued is that reality is being turned into a new commodity class called behavior. Okay, so does this mean we have no more privacy? I would say no, it doesn't mean that. What it means is that privacy has been redistributed. There's actually a lot of privacy, but instead of everybody having some privacy, what's happened is the surveillance capitalists have usurped our privacy rights. So they have all the privacy and we're left with no privacy. And they use that privacy to carry on this business without our being able to inspect it or control it. So there is now not only a concentration of information power, but there is a concentration, a hoarding of privacy rights. All right. So I don't know about you, But when I see an entity like this usurping our rights unilaterally, asserting its authority to take our rights without our permission, asserting its authority to take our data without our permission, I see this as politics. And I want to say that Google represents a revolutionary new politics. It's a revolution from above. It's a coup from above. It's not a coup d'etat. It's a coup de gens. It's a overthrowing of the people, not of the state. And that's why Google, which began as something that intended to empower us, has become something that represents one of the darkest threats for our future. All right, so when I talk about an overthrowing of the people, what I'm seeing as the natural progression of this kind of development is an automated passivity that attempts to reduce us to our animal condition. And our animal condition is one of stimulus and response. So this new world of monetized reality is attempting to place us in a vortex of stimuli to which we respond, just as the old behaviorists used to put rats in a maze and call it operant conditioning, to give them the shocks, the rewards and punishments that would allow the scientists to predict the behavior of the rats. That's the direction that surveillance capitalism is taking us. Is this going to fix our problems of income and social inequality? Is this going to fix the divisions in our society? Is this going to fix the problems that a contemptuous capitalism has produced? My answer to that is no. Instead, it's going to institutionalize these problems in a universal digital infrastructure to which people must submit if they want to participate. So what do we do? Must this be our destiny? And that's where you come in. My answer is no. This must not be our destiny. And to prove that to you, I want you to do one thing for me, which is look at the person standing to your left. If you could do that right now, look at the person standing to your left and please shake their hand. Look them in the eye and shake their hand. All right? Now, look at the person standing at your right. Look them in the eye and shake their hand. It's not corny. It's important. When you look at the people standing beside you, you are not seeing illiterate serfs. This is not the 14th century. What you see is an educated, thinking, critical, opinionated individual. That's who we are. And people like us are not going to let dark Google be our future. Here are the things that we need to know. First of all, that we are only at the beginning of this new era, only at the beginning. If we compared this 2014 to the 20th century, 1914, we would be in the 20th century at a point where Ford had only been manufacturing Model Ts for a couple of years, and General Motors was a small startup company. All right, so we are only at the beginning of this new information civilization that will dominate the 21st century. Ultimately, the successes of capitalism back in the 20th century, including the many decades of shared prosperity, those were shaped by the gradual development of legal and social institutions that amplified capitalism's social benefits and tamed its excesses. Just what Piketty was talking about. When we look forward to life in the year 2040, when most of you will be in your 50s, I assume, everything that is true about life in the year 2040 will depend upon what we do now. What we do now to build new institutions, to insist on new laws, to insist on alternative, positive, pro-social forms of information capitalism that do not subjugate us, but serve us, that align with our needs for effective life and do not try to usurp our rights, but rather allow us to flourish. In 2040, we will look back at this time and we will see this time as the beginning. Like capitalism itself, the power of a company like Google or any expression of surveillance capitalism is not to be eaten raw. But we are the cooks. We must cook it. We must cook it with a reassertion of democratic rights, of oversight, and of law. We must tame it with real competitive alternatives that express positive and constructive market forms aligned with our true needs and aspirations. This is our democratic challenge. And we must not turn away from the demands of this challenge. The century ahead, if it is to be a century in which we all flourish, depends on us now. Now, I don't want you to think I'm talking about utopia. This does not mean that we should construct utopias, but rather it means that we have to draw upon the authentic promise of our own aspirations, our own individuality, and our own sense of democratic values. We have to draw upon the promise of the digital as we understood it before Edward Snowden entered the terrain of history. In the shadow and the gloom of today's dark Googles, it has become fashionable to mourn the passing of the democratic era. But I want to say that democracy is the best that our species has developed so far, and woe to us if we abandon it now. The real road to serfdom is to allow ourselves to be persuaded that these declarations of democracy that we have inherited are no longer relevant to our digital future, that they will be overwhelmed by these powers of surveillance capitalism. But these things are inscribed in our souls. And if we leave them behind, we leave behind the best part of ourselves. If you doubt me, try living without them. I have done that. I have been in countries without democratic rights. I have lived in countries without democratic rights, and it's not an alternative. That is the wasteland, and we should fear it. But I want to leave you with this thought. I do not fear it because I do not anticipate it. And I do not anticipate it because I believe in you. My hope for the future rests in you, and you, and you, and each one of you. That's the promise. That's the promise of today. So go, do. Thank you.
Thank you, Shoshana Zuboff, for this statement. Please stay with us. We're going to continue to discuss here and reflect on what you said. Once again, I want to invite the audience to reflect on what was just said and to maybe agree or disagree. Send us your comments. The hashtag is E14Reality. We at the Elevate Festival, we serve food upstairs. It's vegan. So I would say we might need a vegan form of capitalism. We might cook vegan in our kitchen in the future. And I want to start with Felix here on the panel. Can you reflect on what Shoshana is saying, on her opinion?
I mean, there's a very broad-ranging topic. But I'm not sure I really agree with the conclusion in the sense that the alternative is to either restore democracy the way we had it, to cook capitalism again the way we had it, or face a wasteland. For two reasons. First, historically, what cooked capitalism was the very real kind of competition with socialism. Whether that was an actual competition or just an imagined competition, but that put a lot of pressure on capitalist institutions and states to kind of mitigate against these tendencies that, as far as I understand Piketty, are kind of inherent in unregulated capitalism, that they increase social inequality. And for that, I also would say that social inequality is not necessarily our biggest problem, even though I totally agree that unequal societies are dangerous and unstable and prone to all kinds of bad things. But for me, that's inequality is an effect. It's a reason, or it's what happens after because of certain ways of organizing. And so for me, it's perhaps more the question of restoring, of actually the question of how can we think kind of democratic institutions anew? Because even though I don't think we should lightly abandon whatever we have in democratic institutions, I think they are extremely hard to reform the way they are. So for me, the question is how can we extend them into new domains and think about new democratic institutions that are outside this kind of standard framework of representative democracy. So how do we, for example, extend democratic participation into the economy? How do we do that? How do we avoid this tendency to disembed the economy from society, and how do we create environments in which economic incentives and social incentives are mixed and are equally important to one another, rather than have them separated the way we have them. So that, for me, while I agree to some degree with the way the problem is described and the way this new capitalism that doesn't need us either as producers or as consumers, right? And it creates kind of a lot of surplus populations, and they become very unrestive. And they not only become unrestive in the Middle East, but everywhere. And that's very, very dangerous. But I think the idea of restoring something is not gonna work, particularly not under the increased pressures that we are facing with all the other kind of non-digital problems we have, global warming and all of that. So I'm slightly skeptical of the conclusions that are drawn.
Miriam, what about you?
Well, thank you, Shoshana, for your inspiring statement. I was thinking two points, and to start with Google. Well, first of all, I think Google is not the only problem, so we have to talk about it in a broader sense. But to start with Google, it's not only that in the future they will evade our reality and our daily lives. I think that is something that is already happening. And if you only look at like the way Google is designed with the white screen and there's just one search bar and you type in your search query. It looks very objective, and of course, probably most people here know that there's all these algorithms and filter bubbles. But for like the billions of users of Google, it looks like an objective tool. And I think the first step would be to kind of explain that this is not the way it is. And even when you type in your search query, you see what's it called? The automated
suggestions.
Yes, thank you. And these are already ways to interfere, I think, with the way we use the tool. So not only is it like what you get out of it, your results are biased. Already your search query is biased by these automated suggestions. So this is just a very subtle way in which Google already interferes with what we look for. So for example, if I'm afraid I have some kind of disease and I start Googling symptoms I have, I will see the suggestions and this will lead me in a certain direction. And then Google knows I'm searching for some disease or symptom. And I like the point that this leads to more inequality, but I think that's only one part of the story because it's like an inequality where very few people have a lot of privacy or money and the majority has very little privacy or money or whatever. So that's inequality, but I think this automation and this like supposed objectivity also makes like the majority into some kind of equal unindividual mass. So you are directed into a way of searching, of getting results, which is not making you more individual, but more, well, equal in a bad sense. So that's what I would like to add in that direction. And then, so that's the problem with Google. It's really like the design and the way it works. On the other hand, I'm also a bit skeptical towards looking at the institutions for a solution because it's of course a problem in the whole of society that everybody's gathering all this data about you, and it's not. You can hardly live your life without going along. I'm from the Netherlands, to give an example. You can, but it's really difficult. Travel by train without a chip card, and you can buy an anonymous chip card. But that's really complicated. So you don't do that. And if you work, I mean, I have to travel to my work every day by train. So I get a chip card for my work. And I'm not going to have like all these separate chip cards for when I'm privately traveling. And, you know, so that's really complicated. And this is also just a lot of data that is gathered by my government about me. And I don't know what they do with it. So, and I'm a little bit of a rebel, so I have a chip card and I can travel through the whole country 24/7 for one fare. It's really expensive. So I thought, you know, I don't have to do the check-in, so they won't get my data because I'm allowed to travel through the whole country 24/7. But this is not the way it works, because then the train personnel comes and they say, you didn't check in. You have to check in, even if you pay like the full price so you can travel for free through the whole country. So this is just an example where a lot of data, and I don't know what they're gonna do with it, but I can imagine all kinds of scenarios where my government will change and they might do something with this data set about me traveling through the whole country. So I think it's not only Google or the tech companies with when it's about reality is taking over our daily life, it's more than only the things we do on our computer. It's really about our real daily lives, traveling, voting, getting insurances, stuff like that. So just to make it even a broader problem, I would like to add that.
So you talk about voting. I'm surprised because that's usually anonymous, isn't it? Is it different in Holland?
No, that's... Okay, maybe I just blurted that out, sorry.
I'm just wondering.
But, you know, well, there's... maybe it's not a question if it's anonymous. It's in Holland, there's always, with every election, and we have a lot of elections, I can tell you, because the governments don't last that long. There's always, again, the discussion whether there's going to be voting computers or if you have to vote by hand. So in the last few years, we went back to voting by hand, which is good, I guess, because the computers which were used at some occasions, they turned out to be leaky and, you know, you couldn't trust them. So, and then whether it's anonymous or not, maybe that's not the only issue. It's digital technology invading our reality.
And the state certainly has a registry of all the voters to invite them to vote. That's what's happening in Austria. And that data can also be used, of course.
And when I get to the voting station, there's a volunteer there sitting with an iPad entering in my registration number and stuff. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's everywhere, I guess.
It's everywhere. Micah?
I want to agree that I think the problem is bigger than Google. I think that Google really did pioneer a lot of this stuff, but at this point it's kind of every time you do anything, there are databases like logging this information. Like in the United States at least, there's traffic cameras that are at like every intersection in some cities that are logging people's license plate numbers so you can track where cars go throughout the city. And this is used to like catch people who are running red lights, but this is just a database with a data set that can show exactly where people have been driving. And I think that it's 2014 and we have a lot of amazing technology that lets us do a lot of amazing things. Like I'm actually very happy about the fact that I'm never lost anymore because I have a phone with GPS and I could just press a button and see exactly. Like, this is my first time in Austria, but I'm able to just like look at the map and see where I'm staying and find directions to walk there. And it's just simple. But it also means that everywhere I go when my phone is turned on, you know, my location is being logged probably by Google, and because I'm, you know, using Google Maps. And also by T-Mobile, and you know, there's various you know, ways that data is leaking out of my phone, but still at the same time, it's an amazing technology that we don't have to be lost anymore in the future, and I think this is just true with a lot of the things that we have now that we didn't used to have. So you know, the web, we all use the web all the time for all sorts of things. And every time we use the web, there are tons of services that track what we're doing and tons of services that make the web more rich. So there's YouTube, and so you can visit blogs, and blogs embed YouTube videos. And so this means that YouTube has records of everyone who has watched all of their videos on what websites they watched those videos. And it makes it so you know, if you want to build a website privately, are you just not going to use YouTube to host your videos? Because then you don't get, you know, when people try and share it, it doesn't get a nice little preview on Twitter and all sorts of stuff. So I think that this is just a very hard problem because everything that we do leaves data trails, and these data trails end up in databases of a wide variety of companies, and many of them we have no idea they even exist. Like you go to a website and there are, you know, dozens of advertising networks tracking you and you don't even realize this. And I think that another large problem with this is this private surveillance is all of this data is accessible to the government, and it's accessible to spy agencies. At least, I'm not sure about the rest of the world, but in the United States, when there's a company operating in the United States, the U.S. government is allowed to request data when they need it, and they're allowed to, you know, do secret requests like national security letters that have gag orders, so the companies aren't allowed to even let anyone know that they're getting these requests. So, if you know your visit, so like you know a huge percentage of websites use Google Analytics to so that the website operators know, you know, how they're doing, how much traffic they're getting, where it's coming from, and this means that as you, as like a user of the web, goes from website to website to website, each of these totally separate websites are all sending their information to the same Google database. And then the FBI or the NSA can go to Google and say, we're interested in this specific person. We've done some surveillance and can tell that this is the cookie that you've stored on their computer. Give us a list of everything they've done ever. And that's just terrifying.
And it was, I mean, this was something that some paranoid people in the tech scene a few years ago were, you know,
yeah.
voicing already, but they were called like lunatics or really paranoid.
Yeah, yeah.
But and now we know through the Snowden documents that this is actually happening on a scale that is unimaginable.
I think that this is actually one of the great things to come out of the Snowden revelations is that it used to be like a small minority of paranoid people who would block JavaScript in their browser because they don't want to be tracked, and they would use encryption and they would set up HTTPS on their websites, and everyone would think that they're paranoid and crazy, and now it turns out that they were completely right, and that like every single bit of information that goes over the network is being logged and tracked by people, and so the paranoid people were right, and so now people like finally people are starting to wake up, and finally websites are starting to use encryption, and things are just starting to go a little bit in a better direction. But there's a lot of things that it's almost impossible to make it go in a better direction. Like, how can I carry a phone that has a map and GPS without being tracked by the cell networks?
Yeah, that's the ambivalence of technology that we discussed here at the Elevate Festival a few times already. We have these lots of amazing opportunities and tools, but we also, we are more or less forced into a corporate world. If I think, for example, about the mobile phone market, I mean, there's Apple and there's Google. There's a few other like operating systems that are somehow a bit more free, but we are forced into these systems. We are forced to have that. And I want to emphasize again, because surveillance capitalism, this term, I think is really important, because, and also the mentioning of it being kind of out of control and raw, because like Micah mentioned, I know that you use this too, I do it too, but if you really want to defend yourself against these mechanisms of websites sending data to other websites, you have a lot of more work in your browsing mm-hmm. experience. It's not like the usual thing, click and go.
And when you do actually defend yourself, again, at least like on computers, like in the real world, if you want to not have your location tracked, you just have to not carry your phone. You know, like if you want to have a private meeting, you have to leave your phone at home, and the other person has to leave their phone at home, and you have to go and meet in person and have a private meeting. Without, you know, phones or computers. But like on computers, on the internet, you kind of can't avoid being tracked at all, but what you can do is make it so that the metadata that you're leaving around and the logs that you're leaving around don't lead back to you. But you're still leaving them all the time. Like, you can use the Tor browser to do research online, and all of the websites that you're visiting are sitting there logging they're logging every web request you're making, and all of the trackers are logging every web request that you're making. They just, you know that this is all coming from a Tor browser, coming from an exit node, and not actually you. So that's how you have privacy. It's not that you're not being tracked anymore. It's that, you know, like you're anonymously being tracked. But they still know that someone from the Tor, using the Tor network, was visiting them.
And I think another big problem is also that this is still, like Shoshana mentioned, we are still on the beginning of all of this. It's not at the end. And I think most people are also the policy makers, decision makers, they don't realize
that there might be chances to regulate this in a way. It's a completely unregulated way to do things. It's like driving on the road without any signs or any rules, more or less, online. And I think that's quite dangerous.
Can I comment on?
Please.
I'm hearing feedback. Okay, I just wanted to comment on a couple of points because everyone is saying such good points, I love everything that's been said. And if I was unclear, I want to correct that because it's very, very important to understand what Felix was saying, that when I talk about looking back from the year 2040, I'm not suggesting that we recreate the institutions of the 20th century. The great institutions of the 20th century that helped us cook capitalism were labor market institutions and social welfare institutions, forms of legislation relevant to the realities of life in an industrial society, in a mass society. And we're not going back to those social conditions. So the real challenge is not about recreating those institutions. The real challenge is to put the ing on the word. It's institutionalizing. It's taking the existential challenges and realities that we face now that everybody has been describing and understanding how we create the new kinds of institutions that reflect our conditions of existence today. We are individuals. We're not who our parents were. We're not who our grandparents were. We live different lives. We have different challenges, including the challenges of the climate crisis. And so the institutionalizings that we have to create to address the situations that we're facing are going to be unique in history. And I also want to just underscore that I'm focusing on Google as emblematic of a new mode of practice and a new mode of capitalism. And of course, it's not just Google. Google is a pioneer, and Google gives us a chance to sort of unpack what's inside the box and look at how it ticks. But the whole point here is that we're creating a digital infrastructure, a universal and automatic infrastructure. And when you look at it now and you listen to the descriptions of getting on the train, that's just perfect. And all the things that Micah is saying, I mean, yes, this is a surround that is already being constructed around us. But what is so important is not to assume that the future is a straight line. You know, George Orwell, who we all love for many things, was also a wonderful philosopher and critic. And one of the greatest things in his writing is his definition of cowardice. And he defined cowardice as taking whatever is happening now and assuming that that is the thing that is going to continue to be happening in the future, because that is subjugating yourself to the power structure of the moment. And that's being a coward. And so when I listen to these descriptions, which are so, so true, I'm saying, our job is to figure out the new institutionalizings relevant to our lives today and the kind of lives we want to live in the future, and impose those new institutionalizings on this growing data reality so that the future is not a straight line from the present. That's the challenge. That's the creative challenge that we face today. My final little comment I want to make. Everybody's talking about, and Mike is saying, I really dig having this map on my phone and not getting lost. Problem is, I've got to give up all this data in order to do it. So I'm a little older than probably most of you, And I know that when I was starting my career, when I started the Harvard Business School back in 1980, the whole deal then, if you were a woman, was that people said to you, okay, you have to choose. You can either have a career or you can have a family, but you can't do both. Now, that might sound really weird, bizarre to you now, but that was very definitely the reality that I lived in when I was your age. And what I said to myself is that is an illegitimate choice. I do not accept that that is a reasonable choice, and I will resist that. And I will change whatever I have to change around me to not be faced with that choice. And I see that as very similar to where we're at today, because all of this data, resource is stuff that we need to be able to live our lives effectively in our current conditions of existence. This is essential for social participation. A few months ago, Facebook had a server crash and people around the United States couldn't get onto Facebook. And, you know, they were actually calling 911, which is the public emergency number, right? Because they couldn't live a day or an hour without Facebook. And can you imagine living without Google search or any kind of search? I certainly can't. The point is we need these things for social participation, but we are being given an illegitimate choice. It's a Faustian pact that if you want to access this for social participation, then you have to give away all this stuff that ultimately allows us to control you in ways that you have not agreed to in a democratic society. You have not agreed to. That is an illegitimate choice. And our new institutionalizings have to confront and overturn that choice.
Yes, I think I would. I just would like to add, I mean, there is terms and conditions on most of these services, but no one is actually reading them, so that's actually also problematic. In the second hour, we can reflect on some alternatives or different ways of thinking of how to approach this thing. Before we give the floor to the audience, to you, for reflection on what was said, I want to stress and give a few numbers and add another thing why I personally also think Google is an important example. I have some numbers. The cash on hand of the big corporations in 2012. Apple, $110 billion. Google, $50 billion. Microsoft, $51 billion. And in comparison, Amazon, $10 billion. And Facebook, $16. That was 2012. It might have probably changed a little bit, but these amounts of cash at hand give a lot of power. That is more cash than lots of nation states have. And another thing I want to bring in this discussion is something from the recent book by Julian Assange that I recommend for every one of you. It's called When Google Met WikiLeaks. I don't know if you have already read it, but it came out recently and it's very interesting because, yeah, Google met WikiLeaks. Eric Schmidt, the CEO of Google, was actually visiting Julian Assange when he was not yet in the embassy of Ecuador in London, but at this country house of his friend somewhere in house arrest in 2011. So Eric Schmidt, the CEO of one of the most powerful corporations, meets by any chance the radical WikiLeaks activist Julian Assange that is really provoking the American, well, military establishment in a very active way. So they have a conversation. This is basically what's in the book. They talk about, well, their project, and they reflect, and they recorded everything, and everyone agreed on that. It's very interesting. Eric Schmidt released a book that's out now. You can read about his position, about the future. But one interesting thing about the book, the team of Julian Assange calls for feedback, the US State Department at the time, and tried to get through to, I think it was still Hillary Clinton at the time, tried to get through to Hillary Clinton and kind of get kind of high up in the phone structure. We're going to call you back. So what happens is the wife of Eric Schmidt calls back. So what does that mean? That actually means that Eric Schmidt is really closely related to the US government and is actually working in a way for the US government. It's no surprise, as we know, that Google and other big corporations are strongly interconnected with the government, the military, the NSA, but it's also in the policy, in the top levels of government. So when we talk about Google, we talk about US actually policy making that's involved in this whole thing. I think that's quite important. All right, I want to give the floor now to the audience.
Hello. Hi. So there's been a lot of great comments. One of them has been done after Shoshana's first speaking. So says he's using one type of sentence, the main clause with exclamation point. Andreas Foster says, I'd say it's dangerous to get romantic about past phases and types of capitalism. Jacob Ferrer says, we are not going to be served by companies anymore. We are going to be harvested. Nadine Koyavesi, that will be with us on Sunday on the workshop. How is it an uprising of privacy if users are giving consent by agreeing the privacy policies in return for a real service? And how is it inequality if anyone can regain privacy with a simple shift away from invasive services? Real alternatives exist. Nafiz Ahmed, who's going to be with us at 6 o'clock in the next panel, makes a couple of comments and a question. Capitalism inherent logic is to dispose his labor from production to maximize profits, hence the logic of surveillance corporations. False binary choice between democracy here and tyranny there, yet the logic of capital has neutered democracy here. Question, what about the Pentagon's Minerva Initiative funding of data mining tools?
Thank you. That was the 140 character limited responses through one other corporation that's, a dominant figure online, Twitter. Nafisa Med, you sent a tweet before, but now you grab the microphone, so you have more than 140 characters to speak. And yeah, that's a good thing.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I really wanted to come back really on two things. One is the way in which capitalism has been framed here, which then in itself creates a real fundamental, I have to say, I thought it was an excellent presentation, but I fundamentally disagree with the conception of capitalism that has been proposed. Capitalism is a relation of production. And if we're going to operate within, you know, Adam Smith's conceptions of capitalism, which completely fail to understand what drives capitalism today, then the solutions that we're going to get are these banal ideas of, well, let's just have new legislation. We keep things going. We have the same capitalist system, but we just have new legislation that's going to sort it all out. And I'm sorry, but that's just completely, that to me is a totally banal response to the scale and systematic nature of the crises that we have. Capitalism is a relation of production. And when we realize that, we understand that the fundamental problem here is the inequality in ownership of production. And that's not just about land and resources and raw materials. Now it's about technology and now it's about data. That's the fundamental problem. So if once we realize that, then this idea that, well, let's just, you know, kind of lobby our governments to like have a few more laws that kind of hold these companies to account, kind of, okay, I'm not saying we don't do that. I think that's an important thing. But really, I think it's kind of losing that visionary ambition, which is, well, why don't we break that monopoly? I mean, surely we should reclaim the commons and reclaim public ownership and access to data, to technology, and break the monopoly of the corporations. I think that's the fundamental thing that I would like to see. How can we actually do that tangibly? Because it's something that I like to talk about, and it's really nice to talk about it in utopian terms, but I think it should actually be a goal. But how do we address that in reality in terms of what we can do with technology, what we can do with ideas, what we can do with politics? Because that's the fundamental thing, and that comes back to this issue of democracy, which is, I mean, now we've got to this point where we can't, you know, we talk about legislating and creating new institutions, but to do that within the framework of representative democracy at current stands, is that really a solution? When our entire Congress and, you know, our parliament are like bought off by corporate lobbies, and these are institutionalized revolving door networks that we can't break, which are part of that whole thing. It's just not, you know, when we're talking about resistance and I just think we really need to be a bit more specific about how we strategize. I'm certainly not saying, you know, let's end democracy and forget democracy and let's not vote and let's not do anything. I just feel like we need to kind of face the reality of that juggernaut and kind of come up with a meaningful strategy of how to do that. But the second thing I wanted to bring up here is the stuff that I've been doing on the Minerva. Have you heard of Minerva? So the Pentagon basically has this thing called Minerva, which is basically like a social science research program. So I broke this story in The Guardian and I did a follow-up story, which The Guardian didn't want to run, which I ran on Occupy.com for reasons of solidarity. And basically what they're doing is they're co-opting social scientists. And this is basically the logic of this whole process. They're getting social scientists, computer scientists to try and come up with new tools to track activists and to predict insurgencies and blah, blah, blah. Which is one thing, but what's really interesting is that one of the things they're doing is, in relation to the whole tech stuff, is they've got a big program called Radical Muslim Discourses or whatever, which is about supposedly about terrorism and security and radicalization, where they've commissioned Arizona State University to create new data mining algorithms, which will automatically like mine everything that is on social media, whether it's Twitter, Facebook, Flickr, everything, and basically categorize individuals, organizations on a threat scale based on these algorithms. And they're bringing in social scientists, so-called, you know, anthropologists, to kind of make this process accurate. Now, that's kind of an example of, you know, this kind of this logic of just trying to absorb everything into this system of, you know, and that, so my kind of concern really is how do we come up with a strategy as citizens to respond to that? Because I feel like the domains, like, you know, in a way, Twitter and Facebook is a public space, but because it's a public space which is effectively controlled by these corporate entities, it's in a way not a public space. So I just don't know what it is that we can do to respond, and I'd be really interested to hear what you can say.
Well, that's what we would... Thank you for this nice moderation of the entry of the second hour, where we exactly want to focus on that. So it's about what can we do about this situation, because we all, you know, humans are easygoing, and as long as it's not hurting every day, we like to use our Gmail, we like to get the feedback on Facebook, we like to use it for convenience. So, do we need to be hurt to change? Or what do we need to do?
Hi. Okay, so there's a kind of politics that I have grown to dislike very much from years of, rubbing heads with it, which is the politics of us versus them. And here, you know, I think it's very fashionable and I think it's very effective when you are wanting to mobilize a political movement to just use absolute terms and put, you know, the bad guys and the good guys, and there's a, you know, the internet's a war zone and they're taking over it because apparently the internet is something you conquer, which is flabbergasting to me. So there's a lot of really big, you know, effective emotional words being used, like usurping the internet. They are conquering the internet, or they are taking the privacy rights for themselves, as if privacy is like currency. It's like tangible. You can hoard it, and then there's no more privacy, as if it's like a piece of paper or something. And so, first of all, no one is usurping anything if there is a clear, you know, transparent, you know, logic as to what is going on. It was never questioned whether Google is harvesting user data or not. It was questioned whether the NSA was harvesting user data or not. Sure, but Google was always required to have a privacy policy that was completely unreadable. Sure, but it was there, and it was never a secret. It was never the case where you could not educate yourself, but just by going on Google itself and searching for the thing and finding out that yes, it is it is there, and they are harvesting your data. And it is not the case that they have usurped society by forcing people to sign up for Google. People, you know, whether they understood it or not, were, you know, voluntarily signing up for a service, and they were in return receiving a legitimate service. They were receiving a useful, you know, fast, efficient service at a cost in which they sacrificed their privacy. And so in terms of usurping the internet, I mean, is it really usurping? Is it really like there's this bunch of bad guys who are conquering the internet with internet soldiers? If you can just, you know, go to duckduckgo.com and then there you go. You have a, you're done. That's it. You just, instead of going to Google, you go to DuckDuckGo, and then even Google's own browser, you can configure it to use DuckDuckGo by default. And instead of using, you know, Gmail, you use Thunderbird with PGP. That's really unusable. But you use one of, you know, MailPile. They're working on a better email.
Yeah, but it's that's
email.
Not so easy, I think. And these alternatives, I think I want to give back to the floor to Felix to respond. How about using that?
Let me step back, because I think this is a really important and very common misunderstanding of how power works. Basically, kind of a slight digress into kind of political theory, there are three types of power, right? One is kind of classic coercive power. The policeman tells you, do that or I will beat you, right? That's very classic. We know that. It's very easy to detect. And the second power is what they call soft power, right? It's basically Hollywood or you know, whatever, French cinema or whatever, giving you all these ideas about how to lead your life and what is desirable, right? But that is also kind of easy to detect, even if it works more subtle. But the way kind of Google exerts power is neither through one nor through the other. I mean, one of the things that always strike me is that today nobody likes Facebook anymore. I don't meet anyone who likes Facebook, thinks this is great. But I also don't meet anyone who says, okay, I'm going to quit it, right? So this is a form of power that makes you voluntarily do things you don't want, right? And why does it, how does it work? It works by creating conditions of sociality. It gives you the tools to lead your own life. And by doing that, it gives you very specific tools that come with a set of affordances. So with, it enables you to do things, it constrains you to do other things. So your choice is either to accept it wholesale or reject it wholesale. And this is, I mean, Shoshana said, it's not a legitimate choice. Because it's, do you want to talk to your friends or do you don't want to talk to your friends? So you say, yeah, I'd rather talk to my friends in a crappy environment than not at all, right? I mean, you can break that down in some more easily, right? As kind of to a simpler thing. What are we doing here? We're in a German-speaking country and we're having an English-speaking discussion. So the price to contribute to that debate is to learn English, and as a non-English speaker, to be in a position where you speak in a language that you normally speak less fluent than your own language, right? So, of course, nobody forces us to do that, but these are the conditions to participate in a broad discussion.
Not exactly. We have interpretation, so you can't speak German and listen to it.
We can add to that, but I mean, there are other context, and it's not a critique of you. There are other contexts where you don't have interpretation. If you're a scientist and you publish not in English, basically you can you're restricted to very very small segments. So these are conditions, and we're free to operate under these conditions. They don't tell us anymore what to do, but they just kind of slant the level, the playing field, right? So yes, this is not a territory that gets absorbed, but this is a territory that is getting slanted. So to do certain things becomes harder, to do other things becomes easier. So kind of social gravity is pulling people into one direction. Yes, you can walk against that slanted surface, but it's very difficult, and there's only so many times you can do that. So you can say, yes, I'm not going to use Google, but I'm still going to use public transportation with this chip card. Yes, I'm not going to use this, but I'm still doing other things. So I don't think this is a, it's a fundamental misconception of how kind of power works and how these systems work. They don't tell you anymore how to do things. They're not requiring your consent. They don't care if you hate them. It's not about It's not about kind of this creating cultural hegemony and getting everyone to agree more or less on something. It doesn't matter. You can hate Facebook. You can post every day, I hate Facebook. They like it because you post. You use the system. They don't care what you say. These are not... I mean, Shoshana also said that, right? These are not... We think of these things as communication platforms, but they're not about communication. From the point of view of the people who create these platforms, they don't care what you say. As long as you use them, as long as you produce data, that's what these things are about. They're not about communication, so they're not about content. They're not about arguments, right? They're about kind of constraining and shaping behavior.
But a lot of people, I think, face really a big dilemma because you are drawn into the things. All your friends are there. Mm-hmm. How do you want to communicate? Some people don't even have access their email anymore, and you have to be on Facebook or something. It's really it can be very annoying, and even for political activists, I think it's really really problematic these times. And when you enter it or are there present with your project, you in the end you do advertisement and you draw more people in. It's really a dilemma.
Yes, I don't know. I think that's really pessimistic to say that you can't communicate without using Facebook. I mean, I know a lot of people who don't have Facebook. I think you don't have Facebook. So there are ways to have a fulfilling social life full of meaningful communication without using these platforms, in my opinion. But and I'm on Facebook, by the way. And I'm also kind of surprised that you call it a public space. I mean, Facebook, a public space. I don't know, maybe we thought that like really in the beginning. And of course, with all the activists also using Facebook and some good things coming out of that, some bad things coming out of that. I think after that point, nobody will call Facebook a public space anymore. Also because, of course, there's a lot of communication going on there, but I agree with Felix. The height of Facebook is over, I guess. People are just... Don't you...
No, that's not what I meant.
Well, okay, the popularity of Facebook. Or...
It depends how you define popularity, but what I meant is that people are still using it even though they don't like it. And this I find amazing. And I don't think this is coming to an end. Maybe they switch to something else, who knows. But
then do you think they use it for meaningful communication, or?
I would guess. I mean, usually people are not stupid, so they use it for things that are meaningful to them, yeah.
I thought that the analogy of the shifting playing field was interesting in that it becomes slanted and then you lose your balance. And as time goes on, it becomes so slanted that the effect of gravity overtakes your ability to resist it. And this is kind of what is happening in the US, where the US government can actually serve legal papers on Facebook because of the real names policy. You know that it's the person that they want to serve the papers to. Can you actually opt out of that? That's a question of, yes, you can never sign up for Facebook in the first place, but I have a Facebook account. I haven't logged into it for 2 years. Can I still get served papers? And if they said, we subpoenaed you, you didn't respond to them because I haven't logged in for 2 years. This is like the situation. The Facebook actually wants to become a legal entity, wants to become incorporated in the state apparatus. That's what it's striving for. With the real names policy, it wants to become a legitimate apparatus of the state.
Yeah. Before we have another statement from the audience, you just inspired me to have a little idea. We could actually all log in with our neighbor's name, make an account, open it, just register with the real name, the real data, and never log in.
That would yes, be a nice please. Project.
Yes, thank you very much for all these interesting statements. I'm not an expert in programming or business in any way. But the way I see and understand what is going on is that we are very much bothered with our private personal information being used for someone else to make profit out of it. And I think and fear that this is somehow maybe just a symptom of the bigger problem. And the question that is constantly popping up in my head is it even possible for democracy and sort of freedom and private life to coexist with capitalism at all, whether it is now surveillance capitalism, earlier it was other type of capitalism or neoliberalism or whatever someone might call it, but is it even possible or aren't we already at the state where we have the possibility to connect through some platform, or maybe we should agree on one, I don't know, but to connect and to start rethinking and reconsidering every term that we know, democracy or politics, what is parliament supposed to be like? We have the possibility to make it public and not anymore, I don't know, run by a few corporations probably. So this is really my question, maybe most to Shoshana, whether it is possible for capitalism and democracy to coexist.
Shoshana, maybe answer directly.
Well, how about a nice little simple question? I think that, you know, when you dig into this history, what becomes pretty clear is that democracy, I mean, certainly going back into Britain and the rise of industrial capitalism, there are good arguments to be made that democracy emerged really as a condition for capitalism to work, because the populations were required for capitalism, for industrial capitalism to be successful. And because populations were required for that success, over time there was enough pressure on elites to give up some power, to share power. And that power sharing process eventually developed into democratic institutions, so that the rise of capitalism in a market-based capitalism and the rise of democracy have been very, very imbricated, very intermeshed. There are very, very salient ways in which they depend upon one another. I've heard in the conversation the skepticism about capitalism and the real questions about how far can capitalism actually be adapted to serve our needs now and the way that we want to live. And I would put out this one idea, and that is that capitalism has survived for many centuries, not by being the same thing, but actually by always changing, by being very plastic. And in each era, well, you can see in the history of capitalism this kind of oscillation between, and I was interested that Felix used the term disembedded. I've actually just finished writing a paper about oscillation between embedded and disembedded forms of capitalism. And that there are times when, because of the way we create new institutions that express our needs and our demands, we tame capitalism and we hold it tightly to society. It's embedded in society. And in those periods, capitalism has tended to be very productive for society, more than other alternatives. The fact that so many people in the world have a higher standard of living, have so much more education, et cetera, a lot of these things go back to the productive capacities of capitalism and its ability to adapt. But there have been other periods in the history of capitalism where it has oriented away from the needs of populations. It has been disembedded. Times in the 19th century, early 19th century in Britain for sure, late 19th century in the United States. And it was, you know, decades of struggle and conflict to create the institutions and the institutionalizings relevant to that age to tame it and make it productive for what society needed. So capitalism is not one thing, is my bottom line. And when we talk about the idea was put forward about reclaiming the commons and owning the data, yes, these are exactly the kinds of themes, creating new platforms, as you've just said. These are exactly the kinds of themes that have to be on the table as we grapple with a new set of decades of struggle and conflict to create the institutionalizings that make capitalism what we need it to be for our lives, for our futures, for our families. I don't think that we just give up on capitalism and figure out how we're going to build our new world outside of it or around it. I think we take it and we make it what it has to be for us. Surveillance capitalism is only one market form. And there are many, many kinds of market forms that we can create and adapt that will be more aligned with the kind of lives we want to live.
Yeah, or not, because our opening speaker actually suggested to, well, more or less think beyond capitalism. That's also a possibility that we can and should probably do, I would say. We have one more voice from the audience.
Yeah, I just wanted to come back to the point about using Facebook when you don't like it. I use Facebook and I don't like it. I'm kickstarting a documentary at the moment, and when I go on my page, it tells me that 60% of my donors have come there from Facebook, you know, so I know that, and that's a fact. I'm caught in that situation where I know that that's happened, so I have to use it, kind of, right? But I don't like it, I hate it. So I'm here, I'm kind of agreeing with what you say, and I really respond to it, and I'm just kind of maybe bringing up the fact that if we're all feeling like that, doesn't that present us with a really good opportunity? And I'm not a tech guy, my focus is on other things, you know. I'm kind of looking to you tech geeks to tell me what to do. Like, what is the other platform? And if there is that other platform, how do we engage the general population or people that aren't tech geeks in that?
Well, I'll give a little suggestion just quickly. You ask for donations for your documentary film. There's lots of tech projects that also ask for donations that build these platforms that we probably need. No?
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, just about this whole discussion about alternatives, like people don't need to use Google because they could just use DuckDuckGo, and you know, like people don't need to use Facebook. So there's been lots of attempts at alternative social networks, and there are lots of alternatives that actually work really great. Like you could use a desktop Linux operating system right now instead of using Windows or a Mac, and for the most part, it actually works great unless you're like forced to use Photoshop for work or something. But the problem is that the alternatives aren't as good. I think that's the big problem. Sometimes they are, and in some ways they are. But in a lot of ways, the alternatives just don't work as well. Like when I use DuckDuckGo, a lot of times it's actually great and works great for, you know, what I'm searching for. But, you know, like a third of the time at least, I have to just search Google instead because I'm not finding what I need to find. And I think that you know, investing our resources in alternatives is important. But I also think that it's tricky to actually build alternatives. Like there have been projects, so like if you want a social network that is truly like independent, not controlled by a corporation, it kind of has to be decentralized. It has to work the way that like email works. Everyone can have an email address at a different service and they can all communicate with each other. And so there was like Diaspora was an attempt that kind of failed to be a social network alternative. And
well, but I disagree, it's still there. It's still usable. Everyone could switch in this room, everyone could switch, invite all their friends and change. I think the alternatives are there. And I think there's also hacks that are visible. For example, if you don't want to use Google, I give you a tip. There's a website called startpage.com that uses Google as a search engine, but their server is in between. So Google only sees the server of Startpage giving the request. It doesn't know your IP address, your computer data. So they're in between. They promise not to store anything. you still get some kind of a new, more neutral search result. It's a little hack.
It's not the solution. I think that's the issue is that there's lots of hacks that you can do. Like, there's so many hacks. Like, if you want to be able to have cloud storage but not actually give Dropbox your information, you can, you know, set up a Linux box and use an SSHFS for a shared folder, and it could just all be controlled by yourself. But this isn't accessible to everybody, and this isn't accessible to many people at all. And I think that the solutions have to not be hacks, but it has to be like, if you go out and get a computer, this is just how your computer works. You know, if we want it to like catch on, it needs to just be the default. Like, how people use computers needs to be more free. And it's hard to get out of this corporate dominance, I think, because, you know, these big companies that develop software have amazing amounts of resources. They're able to like hire the best engineers in the world and pay them $200,000 a year to make software that doesn't crash. And so if you want to have like, you know, a video conference, you can use Google Hangout and it tends to work, or you can use Skype and it tends to work. And if you want to use the free software way, you can use Jitsi, and you could have like various degrees of success, various degrees of failure,
I started to call it Jitsi sometimes.
Jitsi, yeah. And I mean, but I think that we should all use these alternatives anyway. But I think that that's the problem is like, if you get a new computer and you want to have a video chat with somebody and you want it to be secure, it's like you either need to be a computer nerd or
Google. I have a question. How many in 10 people in, let's say, our societies are nerds that you could ask for a favor to help with that? It's like 1 in 10 or 2 in 10 that you probably know around you in your circle of friends?
I know a lot of nerds.
We're not representative.
We're not representative. But, I mean, I switched to Linux on all my machines that I use in 2006. I was a Windows user before, but I had a friend just helping me to transport the data, helping me just to set up one day, basically. And since then, I learned to like it and love it, actually.
Yeah.
I think this is one thing to propose. I mean, look around your friendship circles, find someone who knows computers, is probably maybe not just knowing Windows, is operating in the free software world, and ask for a change. You can make a community, you know? You can exchange a little bit. Cook the nerd some food, the nerd cooks you some good operating system. That's maybe a way.
Well, I would like to add to that, to change it around, because I think a lot of people in this room, I'm not a tech geek, by the way, but a lot of people in this room will be some variety of nerddom. So I would like to turn it around and make it more like a responsibility for the people who already know about this. So that's what I do. I try to talk to my friends who are really not thinking about this stuff, and just explaining in plain words why I also think Google is a big problem, or why they shouldn't post pictures of their kids in the hospital on Facebook with the diagnosis on top. I mean, and you know, my friends are also smart people, educated people, and they just don't realize what could happen with this information. So I just try to have a discussion about this and not be too annoying every time. So to turn that around, you can ask your geek friend to help you, but as a geek, you could also help your non-geek friends.
That's true.
Go ahead.
Very briefly. I think hacks and cooking and all of that are great, but they're extremely limited solutions. I mean, it's better to do that. I mean, it's always good to do what's within your capabilities, so it's good to do that. But I don't think this social change happens really by adding small pieces into a pile. I mean, sometimes it does, but I think here it's really difficult because we're within a highly structured space that really constrains these things. So the first hack is easy, the second hack is more difficult, and it just scales very badly. It gets more and more difficult, right? Because it's so such a slanted space. But you mentioned email, right, as a thing. And I think they're actually very straightforward things. I mean, they're actually difficult, but conceptually at least, they're relatively straightforward, right? Why can you change your email provider without losing your address book, right? This is because the way the protocol is designed, Right? It's designed to do that. If I want to change my social network, I lose everything. Right? Why do I do that? Because that's the way the protocol is designed. So you could very easily, again, conceptually easily, politically difficult, but still, I mean, in terms of thinking, right? You could think about how to force these protocols to be more open, more like email. So if I choose to go to diaspora, why can't I see my friends on Facebook? Right, it's very deliberate design, so to make the switching costs really high, and then, you know, pragmatically say no, I don't do it today, maybe tomorrow, but not today, right? But I mean, these, I'm skeptical about lobbying the government to do stuff, but if you want to do that, this would be one thing to do, right? Force these protocols that, you know, different logics can interact. Right now, what we have is that we have very real network effects. Our network is more useful when more people are on it, combined with monopoly effects, right? So yes, these networks are useful, but there's only one of them, right? And email is also networks effects, but not underlying monopoly effects. And you could very easily, again, conceptually, easily distinguish these two. And, you know, force, I would like to have to be able to force a social network like Facebook to have an open API.
Well, I'm really wondering, because here in the EU, we discuss about regulating light bulbs and other details that are quite specific, but there's obviously that it's still at an early stage that also the politicians, decision makers are really aware what this technology actually means and is capable of.
That's right.
There's lots of unreflective use of technology. Shoshana?
No, I'm saying yes, yes, yes. These are all arenas that, you know, somebody was saying, well, it's not right to say that they've usurped. But these are all examples of a typical modus operandi that we've seen with the tech giants, which is first they assert and then they wait for pushback. So, for example, in the case of Google and Facebook, there are hundreds and hundreds of lawsuits against these companies for the ways in which they have inserted themselves, you know, street view, slurping up all kinds of private data from your family's Wi-Fi system inside your house and whatever that nobody knew about until it was accidentally discovered. And so what they do is they encroach on this territory that is new territory. It's unmapped territory. It's a blank space. And they encroach in it with the protocols, which are actually, you know, expressions of a certain structure of power and commercial interest. And then they just wait for pushback. And so far, there hasn't been very much pushback, and certainly not very much organized pushback. It's individual lawsuits. They end up paying a small fine, which is, you know, pocket money or less. And so what they have institutionalized in these blank territories is what gets to stand. And that's why when I talk about institutionalizing, I want to make it clear, I'm not talking about just like you build a building or something, or you invent a new kind of parliament. Institutionalizing is a lot of, it's a lot of more subtle stuff. It's naming things, recognizing, and, you know, just the way Felix was just naming the inner structure of that protocol and how it pushes us one way and deprives us of other choices. Just that very naming is an institutionalizing that changes the reality. The last comment I'd make about this is that linking this conversation up with the conversation about capitalism is we're also talking here about creating new kinds of markets for new kinds of market forms. Because if enough of us decide that we are fed up with the surveillance capitalism protocols of the Facebooks and the Googles and so on. You know, demand is an economic term that actually arises from an existential condition of social need. And so if enough of us have these other needs that are not being met, that translates into economic demand. And so there is slowly constituting itself a new kind of marketplace for other economic actors, other kinds of companies who are going to do this stuff that we want and we need, but they're going to do it according to a different set of rules that is aligned with our interests rather than against our interests. You know, there are guys in France who are putting together a wholly new kind of search engine. It's called Quant, and it's a privacy-oriented search engine that promises not to have the limitations, for example, that DuckDuckGo has. There are many other companies beginning to constitute themselves in this new space as a response to the crisis of surveillance capitalism. That's another way that capitalism works positively to evolve in a way that is aligned with our interests.
Like, the big difference between email and Facebook is that email is an open standard that was agreed upon, like, in an RFC. There's, like, a spec that defines exactly how email works, and if anybody wants to make something and call it email, as long as they make their code work with this spec, then it's email. And Facebook is just a company. And so, like, even if Facebook had a open API and made it, you know, easier to interoperate with other systems like Diaspora or like email, like, they could choose to do this, but they're not actually being governed by a spec that we've collectively agreed on. And I think that that's like the danger of all of this. Like, okay, so there's a new social network, Elo, that a lot of people have been into because they're saying their business model is not about tracking people. Like, you are the customer, not the product, and all of this stuff. But it's also just a company. It's not based on any, there's no open standards. There's no interoperability with other stuff. And there could be at some point, but that's just their choice. And so for this sort of thing to work, I think that we need to, like, agree on standards that make us all equal. And so email has done a good job of that.
It's the free software movement, of course. That's also spanning to open hardware.
Yeah. And I mean, and then, like, another, so another example is Office software. So, like, Microsoft Office is very popular in, like, the business world, and Google Docs is getting very popular. But there's also this nonprofit called the Document Foundation that is specifically, like, you know, has a bunch of document formats where the idea is that they're open document formats that you should be able to use whatever software you prefer the most, but keep everything in the standard format that everyone has collectively agreed on. But people still email me docx files all the time. And it's annoying because there's a standard that's being ignored because people use Microsoft Office or whatever else. And so I think that just, like, recognizing that there are standards and, you know, participating in the standards process to make the standards that we want better and using standards when they're available rather than, like, locked in proprietary systems is a really good thing for us to do. Like, I think that we should all start using open document formats when we're sending Office documents around, even if we don't feel like using LibreOffice, but I think we should use LibreOffice anyway.
Yeah, let's. I think in the last 20 minutes of this panel, we could really get concrete. So it's libreoffice.org for anyone who wants to try it. We have one more voice from the audience, please.
Yeah, I would just like to comment that old saying says, fallen tree makes more noise than growing forest. And there's more developments than just Diaspora in the terms of decentralized social networking. For example, now at the World Wide Web Consortium, there's a social web activity. And there's just one of the specification got to the stage of the first public working draft, Activity Streams 2.0. I participate in this group. There will be TPAC meeting next Monday, Tuesday in Santa Clara. And there are different people participating. There's an indie web camp. So there's many different developments collaborating on having some open standards, open protocols to do social networking in distribution. And on the interesting side, also some people from Google will actually participate in this meeting to coordinate some of their efforts with the open standardization body. So what I would say, many people can do a lot, can ask people from all those different projects and developments how people can help. It's not only crowdfunding. For example, IndieWeb does IndieWeb camps. So if you want to fix some software, improve it, you can do an IndieWeb camp, for example, in your city, invite people, host them, help them with food, space to work, to stay, and so on. So there are many opportunities, just everyone's to step up and say, hey, how can I help? How can I help you? Sometimes geeks actually cannot say what they need. You need to like poke them, hey, what help do you need? What help do you need? I can offer this, I can offer that. So there's many things happening. It's not just diaspora or Facebook. There's more developments.
That's true. I would like to thank you for bringing this RFC process on the table, because I had something similar in mind, but I think the question is, how could we now democratize this process of getting these standards in? Because also with RFCs, the internet got built, but actually, it's not really a democratic process, and I believe since this is all affecting our society, it would be very important to have a procedure in place that we, in a democratic way, can define how this internet and the digital world is being built in the future. And I maybe there are some people working on that or have an idea how we could do that.
Quick answer to that before we have more questions.
I didn't have an answer in mind.
Okay.
But yes.
Yes, okay. Those are... That's...
Yes? Oh, sorry.
No, I was... No. Go ahead.
We have one more or two more statements in the back from the audience, yes?
Yes, hello. I'm Anton from the local crypto party. We are trying to tell the people, protect your data, encrypt everything. Our success is limited, I need to say. Well, my question is, why are the people aware of the problems of all this data emission and possible misuse? I think we are telling always, okay, there are dangers, the data could be misused by Google, by Facebook, by the government, by anybody who is cracking the servers, but actually there is no mass damage by mass surveillance. I searched the internet, but I had a look. There are single cases where people went to jail or had disadvantages for their credit conditions, for example. But actually, there was no big data catastrophe or data disaster, for example. I am really afraid that we need to wait for something like that to happen before the rest of the users wake up and see what is going on. So I would be really interested in your opinion about that.
About some sort of data catastrophe happening before we start waking up. I mean,
Snowden.
I feel like Snowden was kind of at least a first wave of this. Of suddenly we realized that all of this data that's being collected by everybody for so long. That all this data that's been collected by everybody for so long. Is actually also getting collected by spy agencies around the world and getting searched. But I mean, I think that you might be right. People, that might not be enough. Like, we know that they're spying on everything that we do, but people haven't felt necessarily a mass bad things happening to themselves. I mean, I'm sure some people have. I'm sure that, like, you know, like, if you live in the United States and are Muslim, like I'm sure you're a lot more terrified than I am as living in the United States and being white and you know, atheist.
Well, there's historic examples we can always refer to, especially in Holland. If we remember what the Germans during the Second World War, when they invaded Holland,
yes.
they found databases with the religion.
Yes, where everybody had kind of voluntarily given all their data away. So when the Germans came, it was ready for them to find the people they were looking for.
It's not nearly as horrible, but still pretty horrible. In the United States, census data was used like right after World War II started to figure out who all the Japanese Americans were and gather them up into internment camps. And it was
that's
like
horrible.
Census data that's supposed to be protected. You're not supposed to have like the military or law enforcement going looking through census data to like gather people based on their race, but that's exactly what happened, and that's exactly what can happen, except like census data was like people manually going around knocking on doors making a database. Now we just have like we're just like bleeding data with everything we do, and this data is available to people who will start internment camps in the future.
Yes.
And the data goes much further, no?
I mean, this is this really horrific kind of book, the IBM's Holocaust, that tells exactly this story. Why was the Holocaust or the extermination of the Jewish population so much more successful in Holland, a relatively civilized, not necessarily deeply anti-Semitic country, as opposed to Romania, which was deeply anti-Semitic and had very violent kind of street-level killings, because the one were you know furnished by IBM with very good sophisticated databases, and others weren't. So this is really scary. On the other hand, I'm not really sure whether that's the right story, because very few people think of their own government as the Nazis. I think there are very good reasons not to think of your own government as acting like the Nazis. I mean, there are enough people who think that too, but I think generally this is not... It's, if you expect that, then you're going to wait very, very long, because I think political power and political repression works very differently. It's not about a wholesale, at least in Western countries, not about a wholesale kind of repression of entire populations, but about very precise... targeting of individuals. So it's very, very hard to notice until it, you know, arrives at your doorstep, and then you're the only one where it arrives, because it arrived at other doorsteps at other times in other contexts. So I think this is it is very difficult to make this comparison, and perhaps even though it's truly frightening comparison, it's perhaps also misleading. The other point is that I think over the last 30 years, probably what neoliberalism did to us was it decisively changed the way we evaluate kind of government. Traditionally, there was what political scientists call kind of input legitimation. So we were looking at how did a decision come about? Was it was it a fair deliberation process? Who was involved? Was it democratic? Whatever. Right, so a sense of how was this the procedure, and what neoliberalism did, it changed that into an output legitimation. So don't worry about how government works as long as it works for you, right? So, and then the next argument was, well, government doesn't work, private companies work much better, but they deliver the same services but better, so let's go with them. So we are by now in a situation where people have learned to evaluate even the most fundamental questions of basic human rights, basic civil liberties, on this pragmatic, does it work for me kind of level. Mm-hmm. And if you're on that question, you will never be scared of surveillance, because doesn't do much to me. Even though it does, in a very subtle way, but this is not the way that you would think is as the Nazis knocking at your door. It's the way that certain things that you might want never appearing, so you might not even ever know that you didn't want them in the first place. So it's a very different ways of how people are controlled and about how this system operates. So I was also really surprised, because this... well, we need a really big data crisis, is basically what privacy advocates have been saying since the 1970s, right? I mean, the whole modern privacy and surveillance discourse comes kind of with the first databases in the 60s. And there always is, well, it's getting worse and worse and worse, but people don't realize it, and we just need this data super-GAU or something like this, right? And I mean, much bigger than Snowden, it's not going to get, right? Yeah. And and I'm surprised, right? Nothing is happening. And on one hand, because the power structure is very attuned to that, so they don't really want to change that. And people have this ultra-pragmatic output view.
Well, I think what is happening, nothing's happening with the power structure. Some stuff is happening with the power structure a little bit. Like in Germany, you know, there's investigations and things. And but nothing serious has happened with the power structure. But what is happening is people are realizing that this is a problem and starting to fix the broken technology. So people are starting to, you know, make websites use HTTPS to make it so that it's not just trivial for NSA to spy on everything that everyone does. And people are starting to, you know, use encryption more, and tons of developers are starting to make encryption. Like, I think that a big thing that came from this is software developers who have been using encryption for like the last 15 years realize that it needs to be usable by normal people and not just software developers. And that this is actually an important security feature, is usability. And so now there's all these projects to make it so that encryption is usable by everyone. And I think that this is a big thing, that this is where things are shifting, is not actually in trying to get governments to change policies or anything like that. It's in trying to fix the broken holes in the internet. And I think we're actually like at the very beginning of this, but it's going in a really good direction right now.
I think things are happening in many ways. It's a software development, but we also have lobbying organizations in Austria, in Europe especially. We have students suing Facebook, making a big campaign, becoming world famous. There is people actually active. And the crypto party is also a local concept where people get together. It's also this communal thing, which is, I think, really important to get together and talk about these things. We have more voices from the audience in the back, please.
Yes, half suggestion, half question. I wonder if we should not focus the strategy not on the individual, but on the organizations. In other words, a lot of these indie web things are trying to convince consumers to switch from one platform to another. But there are so many social change organizations. For example, in the P2P Foundation, we use Lumio, which is not famous at all with the public, but it's a fantastic consensus-based decision-making tool. And it's spreading virally from organization to organization. So I wonder if, you know, hackers and stuff shouldn't maybe be focusing more on a strategy of getting social change organizations using different infrastructures before you actually compete with Facebook on the basis of individual choice, which seems to me a lost cause at this moment. Second thing, this is a question. You know, we had unions, we had consumer organizations. How is the Facebook user union doing? Is there any sense in expecting some kind of organization of the users of these platforms? Because it's an important part of our lives. And so maybe we should be fighting within, because not many people are going out. We, you know, whether we like it or not, we stay inside. So this is where we have to bring the fight. And third and last question. What about data co-ops? Is there any sense in organizing ourselves and to assert ownership of our own data? And then maybe, you know, accepting that this is in part a commodity, but that can then also generate a return for the people who actually create the value in this particular form of monetization. Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, we're already very far in time, so I would ask you not to ask too many questions. We'll not be able to answer all of them. But maybe briefly, Shoshana, you wanted to add something?
Well, no, I'm saying yes. These are creative examples of new kinds of institutionalizing, whether we call them unions or co-ops, the idea that as users, a word that I detest, we have interests. And that we can organize together, we can collaborate together to assert those interests. I want to draw a quick comparison. Like 1838 in Britain, there was still no word that corresponded to worker or laborer. There were two classes of people, aristocrats and the poor. And it took a while, and very interesting papers, correspondence you can read, for people to figure out that there's another group emerging here that has interests. Oh, let's call them laborers. They're not the same as poor people, right? And that's exactly what you're doing when you're saying Facebook unions. There's a new kind of group here that has interests. Let's figure out what are the right kinds of institutionalizings to assert those interests. That's exactly what I'm talking about. So right on. That's great.
We also had in the afternoon a very interesting example when talking about a project that we recommend to look at from the Elevate Festival's point of view, the Freedom Box, and those concepts like taking technology, opening it up, but also self-empowering, bringing it on yourself, and turning this whole question around, not us having to accept the terms and conditions of the corporations, but us defining the terms. And that is something probably we need to fight politically for, so that we are able to set the terms like people can set in the Creative Commons, the terms for usage of artistic works, maybe be able to set our standards and terms, how we want to use the internet, and then force legally corporations to have to respect that. If I don't want to share data, it needs to be respected. If I configure it with a simple click in the browser, could be something. We have more voices from the audience.
Well, I also want to say that I think that it's hard to assert ownership of data because like data just happens. In fact, like if you run a website and you collect logs, which is a standard running a website behavior because you kind of need to because if things break, you have to look at the logs, look through it, then you're just collecting all this data. And it isn't even necessarily malicious or anything. The only ways to really assert data is to encrypt your data so that you're not actually giving people real data. Like even if you need to use Facebook because that's where your social network is, you can download Pigeon or ADM and log into Facebook chat through that and have encrypted conversations with your friend over Facebook's network, and you won't be giving those conversations to Facebook.
So give a URL for the user so they can download this.
ADM.IM is the Mac off the record chat client, and Pigeon.IM is the Windows and Linux one.
And more on that on Sunday here at the Elevate Festival. We talk more about tools for encryption. We have more voices in the back.
Hello, my name is Irina, and I'm sorry I come up so late at this point of the discussion with my question that actually addresses mainly Shoshana, but brings me back to this whole idea that this mass damage is not going on, apparently, or that the catastrophe is missing. And I think it is going on, speaking in the words of, for example, in Europe, Ilya Troyanov, who speaks about the self-censorship that is going on. And relating to you, Shoshana, when you say surveillance capitalism, and did I understand you right, that you relate this to your topic of inequality, in a sense that because of maybe this enforcement of self-censorship that is going on, or as MIT Sherry Turkle says it, that our whole way of communicating with each other changes so much because of technology that is in use and that helps us to stay away from people because we don't want to interrupt. In fact, we fear to interact. And altogether, I just want to say on one thing, thank you very much for all those analytics and also practical insights. But yeah, now to you, Shoshana, did I get you right? You fear that because of this general feeling of maybe, surveillance, this inequality is something we will not be able to overcome?
Well, you raise such a good point. And going back to the idea of a privacy catastrophe, I agree with what's been said, that the issue is less a privacy catastrophe than the kind of thing that I described, which is a ubiquitous digital infrastructure that is monetized and that those revenue streams are produced by the interventions to modify our behavior. So there's this constant surround that we're living in that is intending to modify our behavior for profit. That is the nightmare scenario, I think, more than the huge privacy catastrophe. Not that the totalitarian issue exists. Edward Snowden says this is a turnkey totalitarianism, which is actually a phrase that he picked up from an NSA guy. And that's true. But way before we get to that, we've got this other thing which is very real and already very prominent. So years ago, I developed a concept that I called anticipatory conformity. And anticipatory conformity is something that I documented in computerizing workplaces where people knew they were being monitored. So they could think about, okay, here's what I want to do, but I know they're looking, so here's what I'll do instead so that my behavior is okay when my bosses see what I'm doing. Anticipatory conformity. What I'm seeing now is a stage after anticipatory conformity, which is where we lose the anticipation part. Because when you anticipate, you're still imagining, here's what I want to do, but here's how I'm going to just pretend to do something else for the camera. But when you live in this data surround that's shaping your behavior, you start to, you stop thinking about what I want to do as something different from what I am doing. You see what I'm saying? How you lose that that part of yourself that anticipates something different from what you're actually doing, because how your behavior is being shaped is no longer in your awareness. How you're being watched and shaped is no longer in your awareness. That's when you get to the stimulus response world. That is my big worry. And that world comes in quietly. It comes in secretly. It comes in without a big bang, without a big data catastrophe. And it takes us from anticipatory conformity, which is what you're raising, to something much, much darker, which is just passivity, stimulus response. And so how we raise our awareness about that before it happens, how we put the barriers up against surveillance capitalism, which is all the money that Daniel was talking about, all those billions of dollars are surveillance profits. How we stand up against that and insist on different economic models. That's essential now so that we don't end up in that place where our awareness is conflated with our behavior. See what I'm saying?
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Add very briefly something to that. The difficulty, I think, in understanding this is that conformity today looks very different to how we used to think about conformity. I think few people know this famous Apple 1984 commercial.
Yeah.
And so when we think about conformity, it's kind of this gray mass of people all behaving the same. But conformity today is something totally different. You're not supposed to behave the same. Everyone is supposed to be unique and producing themselves and being very colorful and expressive and all of that. So in a weird switch, conformity today is the person running in this Apple commercial. So it's very hard for us because we have this notion to see that certain behaviors that seem very kind of personal and unique and expressive are actually very conformist behavior. So it's not about conformity is not about kind of restricting your kind of expressivity and your creativity and all of that, but about very kind of subtly shaping it into a particular direction. It's still creativity and all of that, but it's somehow not your creativity anymore, even though it feels like it yours.
Thank you, I'm Sebastian. as the second part was on solutions, and I was reflecting on that, and I have two ideas. One is about politics. We have to force them to make our realities come true, our dreams come true. And why is there not a field to opt out Facebook? I use it sometimes, but not very often. But if I want to get out of it, there's no possibility. I think companies have to be forced to make this option for me. And then second, I belong to a generation that knows in a world still that has worked without internet. It was also working. It was a nice world. And so for me, it's a form to opt out, not to use it, have other forms of communication, not to use a cell phone. It's possible to do it with a normal phone, to date your friends and make a good social life. So the second solution suggestion that I have is we have to empower our school system, and we have to reform our school system, especially here in Austria as a citizen of here, in a way that social learning is making our pupils, our kids, critical individuals who know that internet, email, social media is a great instrument. As an instrument, they could use it, but they have to also create a critical awareness that they have a life, a part of it. That's what I want to say.
Yeah. Thank you. Do we have more statements from the audience? Okay.
So I'm now wondering that we are talking about software and media or communication infrastructure all the time. So I'm picking up where my fourth talker left over, that there is this offline world that used to work without the internet. And I especially like the work of Ned Rossiter from the Institute of Network Cultures that worked on organized networks, where he is also implying that we need to find new institutions where Shoshana picked off. And I think this is not all about the media and the software and the specs and the Facebooks and the Googles, but the way how we want to design our societies, or what, I don't know, it's not socialism or what being social means in the end. So being a social animal and organizing the daily lives, because right now we're sitting here and not killing each other, we're not hurting each other, we can be peaceful. So this is due to the work of 2,500 years since the early antique philosophers that started to think about human rights and what is important for us as human beings. And I think where we have to elevate is the way how we think in the terms that we don't know yet.
Yes.
I think.
Bravo.
it's like on the mobile phone where the connection fails and you start calling each other. I totally agree we should move forward towards not a future in a straight line, but the future as we want it. But I don't agree that one of the options is disconnecting. I think we really need to face like the fact that we're a connected world. And we can't go back. And I'm also a little bit skeptic about thinking creating a union for Facebook users or social media users. For me, this sounds too much like old world or 20th century. Maybe we need to organize ourselves, but I think it's really important to kind of lose these concepts of the union, or we need to take it political or legal or whatever. And why are we thinking about facing Facebook? I think go beyond Facebook. I mean, if the future is not a straight line, Facebook is not the future. So that's what I would like to add to that.
Yeah, and we already over time a little bit.
the topic is very important and very interesting. I'm sure the discussion goes on. I'm sure there's a lot of buzz going on with the hashtag E14Reality that you can continue to use, because I think this discussion should go on. You should discuss with all your friends, with your family. You should be aware that these systems that you use, this surveillance capitalism that you become the product when you use these tools, is really something that, yeah, should be questioned, and I think it would be good to focus on alternatives. The positive thing that we want to elevate at this moment is that there is lots of tools, there is lots of alternatives. They might be hard to use, but if any one of you is a designer, knowing to have ideas to make things better or give feedback to these projects, they can evolve.
The more people use alternatives, the better they get. I mean, that's if nobody at all used Linux, it would still suck. Except that now there's, you know, a quite sizable community of people that use Linux, and now it's like just as usable as the other major operating systems, and it'll be even better and better and better if more people adopt. And so just switch to stuff that you think is ethically better.
And start with the easy part. Switching mobile phones is really hard.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, there are not really great many alternatives. Switching kind of operating systems on your laptop is really easy.
Yeah. Ask your friends. That's also the thing. Go to your community, find the nerd around you, or the nerdess.
The inner nerd.
And the inner nerd, yeah. And I would like to end this session now with a quote from another time where revolutions were going on. I would just modify it slightly. Be realistic, demand the possible. Have a nice evening. Thank you.